Think Forward. Think Research Channel.
There's a structural problem with genocide, which is that it tends to happen in places that are off the beaten path.
So now, in order to promote nonviolence and reduce violence, ultimately we have to address the motivation.
Society needs to acknowledge that learning is a lifelong challenge.
The sit-ins challenge cherished beliefs most whites held dearly.
At the DNA level, we're all 99.9% the same, all of us.
So individuals do matter. And I think the quality of our individual leadership matters.
Who is speaking for poor people? 40 million Americans make $6 an hour. Who is speaking for them?
The only thing that one has after throwing everything overboard is the love that one can give.
What are some of the pressing concerns that we have for schooling in the United States right now? Well, clearly, you know, we are very interested in what makes for a high-quality classroom. We're also interested in what makes for a high-quality teacher. What are the kinds of ingredients in teaching that matter for kids? We're, in fact, legislating that every child has a high-quality teacher in the United States. What does that mean? It's defined in the legislation, but what I'd like to talk about today is really what does that mean for kids and for teachers in schools. We spend lots of times talking about the performance gaps that exist between kids and groups of kids as they enter and exit school. And we talk a lot about the kinds of morale problems and longevity kinds of things, workforce kind of issues for teachers. Many teachers that we talk to feel as though the pressures and the demands of the profession right now exceed their willingness and ability to sort of hang in there. And that should be of concern to us as well. I come from a school of education, and we're under a lot of pressure to prove that we make a difference. Okay? Does it matter that somebody goes to the Curry School of Education? Does that add value somehow to the work that they do when they go out there in the field? And then, most importantly, and what I'm going to sort of harp on a little bit, is can we approach all these questions scientifically? So the context for the decisions that we're going to need to make about schooling in the next several years clearly drive around some federal legislation. No Child Left Behind mandates all these assessments of kids' performance. We're all living with these things. My junior in high school comes home and he says, if they test me one more time, I'm going to quit school. Those are the realities that kids and teachers face. No Child Left Behind is mandating a high-quality teacher in every single classroom. Keep this in mind as we get further into the presentation, because the definition that No Child Left Behind is, particularly for elementary schools, which is most of what we're going to talk about, is met in almost all elementary schools in the United States right now. So it's because the threshold for the definition of a high-quality teacher in that legislation is actually fairly low, in the sense that they have a four-year degree and some training and experience in the field. We are currently obsessed with finding solutions to the kinds of problems that we think the education system faces by looking at what we as researchers call structural kinds of features of schooling. So we try to say, does it make a difference what kind of tests we use? Does it make a difference what kind of curriculum we use? That's the answer. Does it make a difference if a teacher has a bachelor's degree or a master's degree? Does it make a difference how we schedule kids? We block scheduling, not block scheduling. Does it matter if should we be sending kids to, using vouchers to send the kids to private schools? These are big questions that are driving much of the discourse clearly at the federal level and an awful lot at the state level. Do these things matter? It would be really important to know. And we're going to talk a little bit about that today. And these proposed solutions are all, again, what we call structural changes. They're changes sort of outside the classroom. They don't really deal at a very direct level with what an individual child experiences and what a teacher is able to offer that child in a given classroom, in a given year, you know, in second grade, let's say, in a particular locality. So what we want to do is kind of approach these issues from more of a scientific perspective than from a testimonial or story-based perspective. So that's the context. What are some of the realities that we face? Well, one of the big realities, and it's no shortage of discussion on this, I think probably maybe a little more heat than light, but the gaps in kids' performance in any number of ways you want to cut the groups of kids that you're looking at, from the high performers to the low performers, at the end of school range somewhere between a half and one standard deviation, which if you had a test which has the average score of 100 and most of the kids fall within 15 points of that, that means that the gaps in between high performers and low performers of the type that we tend to be concerned of, racial gaps, income gaps, education, family background gaps, are between 7 and 15 points on that scale. Most of that gap is there at the start of school. Okay, almost all of that gap is there at the start of school. In fact, roughly 80% of that gap is there at the start of school in most of the literature that you look at. In fact, the thing that we know a little bit, particularly in relation to kids in poverty, is that schooling mitigates that gap. And there's a couple periods around which are actually critical action. The preschool to third grade period is a period in which if kids who are coming from tough backgrounds, low income backgrounds, are in high quality programs for a period of time during that period, you can close the gap somewhat and it stays closed a little bit. The lines are still parallel after that point, but you can close it a little bit. And around middle school and high school becomes a bigger point for lessening the gap, or in fact, not letting the gap get wider, which is what tends to happen when kids from low income versus high income backgrounds are going into middle school and high school. And there's lots and lots of examples of gap closing schools. And a lot of people have described those things in a lot of different studies. We're going to come back to this a little bit later. For the most of the time, I'm going to talk about where I do most of my work, which is in the period from preschool to about grade three. When we do surveys of national level surveys of kindergarten teachers, they're telling us that almost 20% of the kids that walk in their classroom door on the first day of school have adjustment problems that they find difficult or serious that don't go away after a couple weeks in school. That's 20% of the population having that level of concern. And I trust these teachers. We talk a lot to teachers in the work that we do, and I don't think they're overestimating that at one bit. I think there's a considerable level of concern about kids, mostly around things like following directions, getting along with other kids, working independently, and some issues around academic skills. Some people have talked about these early school years that go from preschool to about third grade as what's called a critical period. That is, if you don't get something done in that kind of period in development, if you don't set kids on a particular path during that period of development, on a path of success, then they don't ever get there. They don't ever catch up. That strikes me as a little bit of an extreme kind of statement, but there clearly is plenty of evidence that this period plays a unique and disproportionately important role in kids' school careers. Okay, we're going to focus a lot on classroom experiences in most of the talk today. And what I'd like to do is describe for you some steps that we've taken in what is a fairly large-scale effort to try to begin to improve experiences for as many kids as we can in the younger grades over the next couple of years. We're going to talk about what, in reality, when we go into classrooms, rather than talking to teachers or principals through surveys, but when we actually go into observed classrooms, what's the actual nature and quality of experience the kids have preschool to fifth grade? If this is a really important period of time, we should know something about what actually goes on in classrooms. So we'll talk about that in terms of typical classrooms and in terms of variability across the population. It's also really important to know whether all these things that we're trying to debate about solutions, teachers' levels of education, high quality teachers defined by No Child Left Behind, class size, private schooling, do these things really matter in terms of the kind of experiences that kids get in classrooms? If they don't matter, then we shouldn't be paying attention to them and we should start focusing elsewhere. And then we'll try to find out in what ways do the experiences that children have in these classrooms matter for their development. What are the things that close the gap? What are the things that we can go into a classroom, look at, and say fairly confidently that the kind of experience that this child's having in this classroom is either going to contribute to success or not going to contribute to their success? And finally, how and in what ways can we work to improve the richness and quality of kids' experiences in classrooms? So let's start with our observations. We're going to talk for a moment about some national level studies that were involved in observing the actual experiences that kids had in the early grades, from preschool all the way to fifth grade. I feel very strongly, and I think this is borne out in an awful lot of studies that have been conducted, that if you want to know what's going on in a school, you have to sit in the classroom for a little while. You know, talking to people is really not the best way to find out the kind of experiences that kids are getting that really can contribute to their growth. I understand why principals say this. To parents when they go in, but on the other hand, I disagree with the fact when principals will say, you know, at times you'll go in and ask, well, how are all the teachers doing in the school here? And they'll, you know, routinely say, well, all the teachers are doing terrifically here. We got a great school. Everybody, you know, and I understand that, and I know that's why they say that to me as a dad. But on the other hand, when principals tend to report that way on research surveys, that information is not information that we can have an awful lot of confidence in if what we're really interested in is trying to understand the gains that kids can make. So we're going to talk about two different data sets here, one from the National Center for Early Development and Learning and another one from the NICHD study of early child care. We have observations from these studies. We have observations of about 1,000 to 1,200 classrooms at each grade level from pre-K all the way up to fifth grade. The total sample of observations that I'm going to talk about in classrooms, in different classrooms, numbers almost 5,000. So this is the single largest compilation of information about what actually happens to classrooms in the United States. I like to think of this as sort of taking the country's temperature in elementary school. It's going out there, it's a snapshot. We'll talk about being in classrooms basically for one whole day and what we see in them, but it is a snapshot of what school looks like across the country. It has certain values in some cases and has limitations in others. This is just a map that shows the dispersion of the observations in kindergarten, first, third, and fifth grades. It's 1,300 kids that we followed since birth in that study. And then in the pre-K and K study sites, these are the states in orange and blue. Excuse me, I'm too much of a cavalier, orange and blue. Orange and yellow that are in the... That are in the pre-K and K observational studies. In each of these studies, in fact, particularly in the pre-K and K studies, we're representing 80% of the kids who receive state-funded pre-kindergarten programs. These are mostly the pre-kindergarten programs like Bright Stars in Albemarle County, what used to be located in Jefferson Preschool in the Annex, that serve predominantly low-income kids across the country. Okay, so the big question is what to observe. You know, you have lots of things you can pay attention to when you sit in a classroom for a while. So what do we observe? Well, first off, in all of this work, we rely on, these are large scale observations, thousands of classrooms. So we want to make sure when we go in there, we're paying attention to the kinds of things that matter. So the kinds of observational tools that we've used in these studies, all these codes have been selected because they've already been shown to predict to children's skills. So we comb through a number of different studies that have already been done of classrooms, and we try to pick the kinds of things that add value for kids' development over and above what families do for development, that add value to kids' growth during a year that they're in a particular classroom, and that come from highly rigorous scientific designs. So we have pretty good confidence that these are indicators that matter for children's development. When we go in to do our work, we're in these classrooms on a day where we arrange the visit with the teacher. It's a typical day or morning when the teacher tells us that we're doing mostly academic work in this particular day. It's fine for you to come on in. I want to call attention to the fact that all of these teachers are certified teachers. So again, this is a snapshot in some sense of whether, you know, schools of education and school systems are also doing a good job of supporting teachers in classrooms. So I want to make that, you know, make that clear. We pay attention at the classroom level, what kind of climate the classroom has. Is this kind of a positive climate where kids seem to like to spend time and the instructional opportunities that are available to kids? And we also look at individual kids to find out, okay, you know, what are you doing right now when I'm scanning through on a regular basis in the classroom? Are you paying attention to the lesson? Are you being exposed to a particular kind of activity like literacy or math or science? So we pay attention on a time-sampled basis to the setting and activities that children are in, the kind of things that teachers are doing, and we also rate the quality of the environment on global ratings that run from 1 to 7. I'll describe those in a little bit. The ratings that we use focus in two different areas. These are going to be really important because this is the stuff that really, I'll give you the end at the beginning. This is the stuff that really matters when we go into predicting whether kids are growing academically and socially as a function of exposure to a classroom. So the emotional climate of the classroom, we pay attention to, as I said before, is this a place that socially and emotionally kids seem to like to enjoy being together? They cooperate with one another, or is it a place where there's a sort of a harsh emotional tone? Is there evidence that teachers and adults in the classroom sensitively respond to kids' needs? So they're monitoring what goes on in the classroom. They notice a child may be in some altercation or may not be paying attention or may need some support in the lesson, and they find a way to sort of move in there and provide the support the kid needs to keep themselves going. Okay? That would be something like sensitivity. How much does this support children's independence in this classroom? How much are they fostering kids' competence in being able to make decisions on their own within appropriate limits? So those are the kind of things that cluster around emotional climate. Then the other part of this is instructional climate. One very base dimension of instructional climate is just simply what we call productivity. That is the classroom a place where people are doing things, or do they spend most of their time in transition? People don't believe me a lot of times when I say I'll talk about a story. But we literally have watched thousands of classrooms, and I can tell you in one particular third grade situation that we watched, the bell rang for the beginning of the school day, and it was 37 minutes before the children were asked to do anything or provided with any sort of structured activity. That got a low rating on productivity. Then you'll see other classrooms where the teachers do a wonderful job of moving kids through transitions, not in a hurried pace, but keeping the kids busy and active. The other things that are really important here are the dimension of concept development, where we pay attention to the degree to which that the teacher provides the children with rich and stimulating activities that engage their interest. And quality of feedback. Does the teacher provide kids with feedback about their performance and opportunities to learn from the teacher's feedback, rather than simply sort of say yes, no, hand the paper in, and we'll see it. We'll look at the paper later. In our procedures, we approach this like the good scientists that we are, I hope. So when we're sending literally hundreds of people in these studies all across the country in to watch these classrooms, what I don't want back is 5,000 individual stories, like we all might generate. I want everybody to be able to look at each of those 5,000 classrooms using the same kind of lens so that we can begin to understand the variation across those classrooms in what we think matters for kids. So we spend lots and lots of time, I'm not going to go into a lot of detail, but we spend lots of time training people. We use lots of videotaped examples. People are not allowed into classrooms to do these observations as if they passed fairly stringent tests. One of the questions we get a fair amount is, well, you can come in my classroom on one day, but the next day is really different. Well, in fact, we've tested that on a number of occasions by having two different visitors go into a classroom. Because we're doing so many of these, We can't spend lots and lots and lots of time in a given classroom. We have to kind of come in and really do the best job we can within a short time frame. So we need to make sure that short time frame represents how that classroom functions over the long haul. So we've gone in on several different classrooms, several hundred classrooms of this data set, and observed on multiple occasions. And the information I'm going to share with you is information that's very reliable across those different occasions. That means when I go into your classroom on Tuesday and I come back 6 weeks later, the relationship between emotional climate on Tuesday and 6 weeks later is pretty high. So we're pretty confident in that. Okay, so what do we know when we go into here? Okay, and I'm going to summarize these things. You're going to get the broad brush summary here, but these are all from published reports that have been reviewed in the literature, and they're consistent across pre-K all the way up to fifth grade. So what I'm going to talk about when I talk in more general statements is consistent across that time period. When there's something specific to first or to third or something like that, I'll draw attention to that. Well, the vast majority of what happens for kids in a given classroom is what we call whole group or individual seat work. Kids are sitting in a whole group situation, or they're sitting at their desk doing individual seat work. Well, that might not be that surprising to many of us. There are very few, if any, social or instructional interactions that occur between a teacher and an individual child. When we scale this to look on a per hour basis, there are about four occasions during an hour-long observation during the course of the day in which a teacher and an individual child will have an interaction with one another. That doesn't change very much given the number of kids in a classroom or the types of kids in the classroom. Most of what happens in early elementary school is literacy. I don't think any of us are surprised about that. Clearly, that's the pressure that's on teachers and on parents and on school districts. Perhaps the most important thing, though, out of these data are that there really is just exceptional variation across classrooms. I'm going to show you some examples of that. You can go into any given classroom in any given school on any given day. They're all running the same curriculum. And what happens in Mrs. Smith's first grade classroom will be strikingly different than what's happening next door in Mrs. Jones' classroom. Strikingly different from the child's perspective. And we'll talk about that in a little bit. So how do kids spend their time? Well, you get high levels of what we call business or routine activity. So in pre-K or K, you spend a lot of time in snack, lining up, and taking attendance, okay? 30% of your time. Now, you know, I don't know whether 30% is the right amount of time or the wrong amount of time, but what's important about particularly these pre-K classrooms where this is occurring, many of these pre-K programs run a 2.5 hour program, a half day, barely a half day. When you take 30% of 2.5 hours and you take that out of there as learning time, you're diminishing considerably the investment that the public's making in that particular program as an intervention for kids who may need more help than otherwise. In first to fifth grade, kids spend lots of times, roughly again 30%, managing materials and routines. There's an exceptionally high ratio of basic skills to what we call problem-solving focus in the activities that kids receive. I think this is largely a function of the kinds of pressures that have been upon teachers in schools and the kinds of curriculum that are being used in schools. So that, you know, between kindergarten and first grade, if you looked at the ratio of basic skills to a kind of problem-solving discussion activity. And when we define basic skills as something like, if I'm watching an activity that a child's engaged in, is there basically just a yes, no, or a right or wrong answer to what it is that that child's doing? Or is that activity encouraging some discussion, some problem solving, some putting of pieces of information together to come up with a response? All right, so if you look at that ratio, it's 7-1 in kindergarten and first grade, pre-K kindergarten and first grade. By the time you're in third and fifth grades, 14-1. You're going to get 14 more basic skills kind of activities than for every problem-solving activity that you'll receive. This has implications for the kind of learning that we expect to happen in classrooms. Many of us, you know, many people are very concerned about the degree to which kids are offered opportunities to do problem solving and to put information together. Many of the kinds of things that drive our efforts to put pressure on schools are the kinds of tests you hear, oftentimes hear reference to the TIMSS tests and the national, the international exams in mathematics and science that kids take when they're in secondary school. And we don't, we tend to score about 20th of all the countries on those tests. And people often use that information to say we need to teach the kids more basic skills in the early grades. And that may in fact be true, but a lot of those tests test problem-solving ability when you get to that level. And so if we don't build in some problem-solving activity early, some people are concerned that you'll never really get that kind of skill going even later. Okay. I think this is particularly striking. What's the ratio of listening, sitting, and watching to doing something? What's the ratio of passive activity to active activity, where again, you're problem solving, you might be working on a project with kids, and you see again, in pre-K to K, it's 5-1, so little kids get more opportunity to do things rather than sit around, but by the time you're in first, third, or fifth grade, for every occasion that you are actively in doing something like a project and working on a particular activity in a more active fashion, you spend 10 times that amount of time essentially sitting passively in the classroom and listening to someone talk to you. Most of the instruction that children get is a whole class. There is a myth that basically says that a lot of kids get taught in small groups. We simply don't see it when we go into lots of classrooms. I suspect many teachers do teach in small groups, but in the large numbers that we have, we see very little small group or cooperative learning, and that's fairly consistent across the grades. This next slide is a little tough, but this shows in a given hour in first grade the kinds of activities that you're likely to be exposed to. And it's broken down in intervals of 60 minutes. So just, you know, the activity for the most part is going to be teacher-led group activities. The subject areas that you're going to be exposed to, now this is across an entire morning. So most of the, at least actually more than half on average of the kind of activity you're going to get is language arts, which I think fits quite well with the kind of expectations we have for first grade. And you see almost no math, science, social studies. In fact, kids spend more time in transition activities, and that is sort of lining up and taking attendance, than they do in math. Those ratios are actually identical to what we see when we go into a third grade classroom, and we spend all day with a child following them throughout third grade. So we have the opportunity to watch the afternoon where you think most of the science, social studies, and stuff goes on. We don't see much of it. The range is what's really important here. The range in every one of these goes from 0 to 60 almost, so that what this means is that there are many classrooms, first grade classrooms, not a trivial number, where no literacy activities occurred during the morning that we observed. And there are some classrooms we observed where every minute there was something that we could code as a literacy or a language arts activity. What we're talking about here is kids being exposed to strikingly different environments in different classrooms. Okay, strikingly different environments. And again, that range occurs within schools as much as it occurs between schools, between states, between districts. It's not conditioned on whether you're in the same school or same school system. Okay, let's go to those quality ratings now. Remember I talked, we're looking at a 7-point scale here. Ranges from low to high on all these things. So the low is kind of the not, you know, the kind of thing where you probably wouldn't want to have your kid, and the high is the kind of place where you'd probably want to have your kid. If you're selecting classrooms. And you see here in pre-kindergarten, the emotional climate is really centered around a 4, okay, right in the middle of the road. And in K-5, you see this bump up around grade 5. So on average, it looks like kindergartens of 5th grades, not bad places to hang out. They're socially places that we code as particularly, you know, is generally pretty warm and positive. The pre-K environment is a much tougher environment to be in. And that was really surprising to us, because you typically expect environments for younger kids to really focus on some of those social attributes and social interactions. How busy are they? What's the productivity in the classroom? Pre-K, K, centered around 4. Okay, grades 1 to 5 centered around 5. So it doesn't look too bad from the perspective of whether kids are actually doing stuff. Although remember, what they're doing is mostly fairly passive in the sense of listening to a teacher or working on a worksheet that's a basic skills. The ingredients that come from most of the research that we've been able to do that actually have been shown to contribute to kids' growth over the course of the year, both concept development and quality of feedback, you see those centered around a 2 or a 3. These are quite low levels of the kinds of things that happen in classroom that most of us would sit and say, hey, that's terrific teaching. That's really teaching that's going to actually push that kid's skill level a little bit further. Okay, so that's kind of the descriptive piece. That's what's out there. So a lot of variation, not a lot of evidence that we're seeing high quality across the board, and some areas of concern, notably this one here in terms of quality of feedback and concept development. Kids mostly passively engaged in classroom activities. So one of the questions we might ask is, well, is it better in private school? Well, lo and behold, in the NICHD study, we had 200 kids in private schools. So 200 of these observations of 1,000 kids every time are in private schools. So we compared almost 200 private school classrooms with 700 to 800 public schools at each of those different grades. Anybody want to hazard a guess? No differences on anything. You cannot sit in a classroom if you don't know it's a private school and predict that it's a private school on anything we looked at. And in fact, when we look at whether attending a private school 1, 2, 3, 4, or 5 years during the period of kindergarten through fifth grade has any measurable effect on your achievement over and above what your parents contribute to your achievement, there is no effect. Okay, so in this sense, vouchers may not be the answers for kids if what we're doing is using vouchers to try to put kids in a better environment than they might otherwise have had in the public schools. What's the consistency of experience across grades? So if you get a good teacher in first grade, what's the likelihood you're going to get one in second or third? And I apologize to all the teachers in the audience for talking about good teachers, okay? In the NICHD study, in the grades from K to 5, we looked at children who were in the same schools who went from year to year and through our observation system. We saw almost no relationship between their experiences from 1 year to the next. And that's at the level of those quality ratings, but it's also at the level of what we coded minute to minute. So that children's, you know, exposure to, if a child was in a classroom that exposed them to lots of literacy activities as a first grader, there was not much likelihood that they would get the same level or dosage of exposure or intensity of exposure as they moved up. Now that sometimes is due to the child. When we factor in as much as we can about the child and what they bring to the equation, we still end up concluding that it looks pretty random whether you're going to get a particularly good teacher or good experience, rich experience from year to year. From pre-K to kindergarten, we still have the same sort of thing, with the correlations are fairly low and non-significant. So there's a high degree of fluctuation from 1 year to the next. Okay, why is this important? Well, in a minute, I'm going to talk about what classrooms do that really matter. And they really do matter, okay? They matter a lot in non-significant ways, non-trivial ways to kids, and they matter most for kids that are at the toughest end of the distribution, that need it the most, okay? Now, if you're a kid who gets that kind of dose that matters as a first grader, it matters even more that you get that dose the next year as a second grader. Ted Sanders has done work using state-level data in Tennessee where they test kids year after year after year after year, and he's been able to isolate teachers who you know, kids get tested at the end of kindergarten, they go into first grade, and they get tested at the end of first grade. He's got all the teachers in the state. And he's able to look at that information and be able to detect within that information teachers who make reliable boosts in kids. So kids who come in not doing so well, who almost all the time, if you're exposed to that teacher, you get a bigger boost than if you're exposed to the average teacher in that particular state. So, and then he's been able to say, okay, what's the likelihood that if you're not doing so well at the beginning of your school career, how many of these kind of teachers do you need in a row before, once you get a bad teacher, it doesn't matter so much, okay? And basically, his rule of thumb is you need between 4 and 5 teachers in a row that are providing these kind of boosts over and above what the average teacher provides, so that if you hit a teacher who doesn't provide those kind of boosts or is sort of associated with declines in kids' performance, that your performance still tracks positively. Okay, 4 or 5 years. There's no evidence in our data that suggests that that's likely to happen. Okay, let's look at some profiles of classroom assets. When we look at, in this particular graph, this is quality scaled from 0 to 7 over here. This is the midpoint, this red line. The light blue is emotional quality, and the dark blue is instructional quality. And what we did was subject our ratings to a computer program called cluster analysis, which means it tries to find a lot of classrooms that are similar to one another and create groups. And when we create these groups, we find a number of different patterns. You'll see, obviously, here, this is the kind of group that I bet everybody in the audience would like their children to attend. That group is 14% of the population of in the 1,000 observations of first grades that we did. It's the smallest group among all the different groups that we observed. And notice here that these two groups, which compose almost 40% of the entire sample, have those instructional quality bars fairly low. This particular group of classrooms, 20%, is pretty low on both of those. This would be a worrisome kind of group of classrooms, one we should be paying attention to trying to help that teacher. Okay, we do this again in first grade, and not dissimilar findings. So we find one group that looks pretty good on everything, 23% of the first grades. Okay, but then you find again these couple of groups. This one is actually a nice test case, not so high on instructional, but not too bad on emotional. Same with this group. So it'd be interesting to find out whether these two classrooms produce learning. They actually don't produce it as much as we would like, not as much as this particular classroom. And we see this classroom here, 17%, quite low on the instructional dimension. If you paired it with this one, you'd have almost 45% of the first grade classrooms in this observational sample, not particularly high on the kind of ingredients that we think matter the most and have been demonstrated to matter the most for kids' achievement gains. So what aspects of schooling predict kids' performance? I'll just, we take an approach where we try to look at value added. That is, what is the contribution of the classroom environment to the child's growth in achievement and growth in social skills? And we try to control for family and demographic factors, the kids' performance on prior tests, all those structural features of schooling that we talked about, the teacher's education, class size, that kind of stuff. And so we're looking at whether and also whether features of schooling matter more for different kids, different kinds of kids. And what we've been able to detect quite clearly is a very robust findings that teachers for academic achievement and social skills, when children are exposed to classrooms in which there's evidence of teachers' sensitive responsiveness, the kind of individual involvement with children that I mentioned before, when feedback to the children is high and frequent, the kids get feedback on their performance and interactions with teachers, that language between teachers and children is rich conceptually, when teachers and children are provided engaging learning formats that draw them in rather than have them sit passively, and when teachers report positive relationships with students. All of those things contribute in a very measurable and detectable way to kids' performance. Not more than families do, but definitely over and above what families do. Quite reliable. We call this kind of teaching here intentionality. Okay, it's focused, it's engaged. It's a sense that it's directed, that you watch these interactions and you know they're going someplace in terms of learning for that child. Okay? Now, we also see higher levels of social problems under some circumstances. This is particularly the case in first grade in one study that parents actually report their children to show many more signs, not dramatically more, but significantly more signs of anxiety when they're exposed to highly structured classroom settings that lack social and emotional responsiveness. So if all you get is a high pressure without much warmth and high social social value, then kids show some higher signs of anxiety. And problem behavior is also increased in classrooms where children are routinely given activities where there's very low engagement value, where they're actually the activities call for more passive kinds of involvement on the part of the child, and teachers report more conflict, and we observe less sensitive interactions. Okay, these are not large effects, but they're significant. School matters, okay? I mean, sometimes I get in front of people, you know, you say school matters and say, well, big deal, school matters. Well, in fact, there's much of the federal debate is around whether school matters. What's more important is that these effects that we're looking at matter more for certain kinds of kids, for certain kids. And we'll talk a little bit about that in a minute. But just in terms of some other findings from this research, we see almost no effects whatsoever on kids' social or achievement growth for teachers' education, their experience, class size, public or private schooling. This is all the stuff that generates lots of heat but not much light in terms of public debate. We see robust, consistent, and stronger effects for what happens in families. And most of all, what happens in families before kids go to school, that set them into school on a good, solid trajectory. We looked at particularly moving from kindergarten to first grade, whether being exposed to particularly high quality emotional environment in first grade or a high quality instructional environment in first grade made a difference for different groups of kids. And in this particular case, we're looking at kids who come from families where there's a low educational level, in this case, relatively low in this sample meant high school degree or below, and people who came from a relatively higher educational level, which meant beyond a high school degree, most of them college degree. Okay. Now look here. In this particular case, we have they're standardized tests of achievement where there have been an adjustment for the child's prior achievement, and then we've rescaled them. But it's essentially what you're able to do here is to compare first grade achievement for children from low education families. This is under conditions of low instructional support, and this is the same kids, not same kids, but same group of kids who just happened to get into a high instructional quality environment. And you see, in fact, they're indistinguishable from the kids who come from the college educated and above families in that particular environment. And pretty close in that environment, too. Okay. But remember, this low instructional low instructional support environments tend to be fairly frequent. So you're just lucky if you get into this environment rather than that one. But it matters. In this case, first grade is contributing over 3 points to that child's standardized test score. Not bad. If you gain 3 points a year, a couple years in a row, and solidified those gains, you might close gaps. How about in emotionally supportive classrooms? So does it matter if there's emotional support in the classroom? Here we took kids who the kindergarten teacher said had lots of adjustment and achievement problems in the kindergarten classroom at the end of kindergarten year. These are sort of kids where teachers sit down and try to decide where these kids go the next year. Nobody really wants them a whole lot. So you got kids with no problems and you have kids with multiple problems. And you put them in classrooms that differ on the levels of emotional support. And look at the multiple problem kids. Again, standardized tests of achievement over here. These multiple problem kids in a classroom with high levels of emotional support are, again, indistinguishable from the kids who had no problems the year before. Okay? And these are not small groups either. We're talking about 100, you know, in a sample of about 1,000 kids, we're talking between 100 and 200 kids who are in some of these groups. And this one here, you have almost a 4-point gain that can be in part attributable to that particular environment. Now, again, that's a high level of support. Low and moderate levels didn't make it. You have to have a particularly high level in that particular case. So schools matter. They matter for everybody, and they matter even more for kids who need it more. That's the story there. So in the elementary grades, there's this generally positive social climate. We see lots of variability. We're concerned about this lacking intentionality. No associations with structural features. Teacher credentialing, education experience, curriculum doesn't matter what we see. When we compare groups on those things, it doesn't matter. The everyday experiences in classrooms and relationships with teachers, that's what matters. So, if that's what matters, Then the question is, how do you fix it, okay? Or how do you help make it a more uniform experience for kids, not lucky, okay? And make it an experience that might happen for more children, okay? So the implications we have, that we've derived from this, and I'll talk very briefly about what we're working on now, is that, you know, from as we look at our data, the focus of the of educational discourse in terms of school reform and improving it, improving the lot of life in classrooms, both for kids and for teachers, needs to be paying attention, from our perspective, on relationships and interactions. Okay, not structural features. We should not be spending all this time talking about class size or as much time as we talk about curriculum. Those create platforms, okay? They create sort of a common denominator, but it's a fairly low bar. That most of what happens in a classroom, that where learning, gains in learning can be attributed to what goes on in classrooms, happens because of what teachers and children do together. So it's not just the curriculum, it's how it's implemented, it's not courses or degrees, but it's training and support for teachers. Very different. Implications for what we do in the Curry School. Okay, we want to we talk about striving toward moving instructional dimensions and implementation sort of up the scale of quality. We think we're, you know, these classrooms seem to be places that are socially positive but instructionally a little passive. And so how do we meld, you know, good social interactions in a warm, positive environment with a little bit more intentionality is the real question to that I think we face in trying to scale up. How do we guarantee more uniform and consistent exposure to high quality? And in our view, resources need to be aimed at supporting teachers in high quality teaching. And in fact, we talk about having standards for classroom, not standards for kids. That in fact, we ought to, that shift in the discourse would be to focus on ensuring high quality of the type that I think we observe, rather than high quality of the type that you find out from when people fill out questionnaires of whether they have a four-year degree. And in our model, we rely a lot, on standardized observation to provide accountability for classrooms and support to teachers. So we're all interested in social and academic outcomes for kids, and we are really interested in improved teacher outcomes. And in fact, this needs to be even far more elevated as a concern, because many teachers are leaving the profession and the shortages are going up dramatically. We spend a lot of time talking about professional development, whether we're spending enough money, whether we're testing the right things, or whether we have the right curriculum, and we try to line these things up. But the only way they really line up is through what happens between teachers and kids in the middle. This is sort of the point that I've been making. And we think that the data that we've been able to present here now from these large observations, where we have quite reliable and findings about the kinds of attributes of classrooms that matter, provides us a platform to now go in to see whether we can start helping teachers to change those things and support the kind of work that goes on in classrooms to raise raise the ratings that we might otherwise get if we were in these classrooms. And so we use an instrument called the CLASS to do this, and we're looking at ways in which the observational assessment essentially filters those kinds of attributes of classrooms that we spend so much time on, and in particular, we're very focused on the issue of professional development and training. And so for the next just couple of minutes, I'm going to talk about how we're embarking on a new initiative, working with the state of Virginia's pre-kindergarten programs. We're starting at a very early phase here, because we think that's the evidence is where that makes the most difference for kids. And we've tried to, in this way, invent a new way that schools of education reach teachers in the field, and new ways for teachers to receive support in their classrooms that's based on their actual practices with kids, not support that's based on them coming to me and me lecturing to them in my classroom at the Curry School. So we call this initiative My Teaching Partner. This is the initiative that's supported by the grant from the National Institutes of Health. Teachers receive different layers of support in this project. We're interested primarily in trying to impact student growth in language literacy and social relationship. These are the key aspects of school readiness. We give teachers a whole set of activities in language literacy and social relationships, but as we've said, the key thing is how do those things get implemented through teacher interaction, teacher-child interactions and relationships that we, in this particular project, assess using this observational tool that we've developed based on the work that I just talked about. And how do we provide this in as efficient a way for as many different teachers? And we've used the World Wide Web as a mechanism for doing that. In many ways, an experiment. Many of you may be familiar with telemedicine, where our doctors at UVA are able to communicate with doctors in Southwest Virginia about a particular procedure that doctor in Southwest Virginia may actually be doing on a patient at that moment. And in many ways, we think this is the educational analog of telemedicine, where we're able to contact directly teachers about their practice in their classroom and provide them support and feedback about the work that they're doing. So the way this works, I'm going to run through this very briefly, but everybody gets access to a website, on that website are a whole lot of different resources. We have 240 teachers enrolled throughout the state. This is actually well more than half the number of children in the state of Virginia that are enrolled in the Virginia Preschool Initiative are covered by this intervention. It's about 3,600 kids in these particular teachers' classrooms. All the teachers receive access to activities. One of the challenges in early childhood education is that teachers are having to struggle with this issue of how much I actually teach kids and how much I teach them through play. And that this is sort of a battle that goes on a little bit in early childhood education. And much of what teachers are told to do, they're told to teach literacy, but they're not given a lot of support for how to actually do that. And so we've spent a lot of time writing out a whole lot of activities that can cover a teacher's work from September 1st to May 31st in their work with kids around literacy and social relationships. What's very cool about this, in our view, is that all of these activities are keyed to a whole set of extras that teachers can access on the website, and a second group of teachers actually gets access to these extras, and they involve teaching tips for how to implement these activities well, and some other examples, video-based examples of how these activities look when they're being implemented in a way that we would rate as high quality using the assessments that I described before from our observations. So this would be an example of a teaching tip that a teacher might receive for how she might implement a phonological awareness activity. But even more intensive is a layer of support we now provide teachers. In a third of the 80 of the teachers are enrolled in what we call a consultancy relationship with people who sit here at UVA, who don't travel all over the state, but who are able to see, because these teachers tape themselves implementing our activities and send them to us, our people here are able to see teachers as they're practicing in the classroom and able to provide them with direct and regular feedback and support about their practice in that particular classroom. So this is an example of what one of our teachers is enrolled in an activity particularly here. And the consultancy relationship is really built around that kind of observation. And so what happens in this particular case is that the teacher will videotape her implementation of an activity at a particular time. Some of these teachers are from very far away from here. They ship us the videotape. Our consultants look at that videotape, edits it, and posts it to a private website with some questions for the teacher to look at the edited tape, and it's edited in a particular way. Teacher gets some feedback about her practice and support. She gets to reflect on the consultant's questions and observations about her practice. So the teacher gets to view this, and then the consultant and the teacher meet over the internet in a video conference, a mini video conference over the internet, and discuss this whole cycle of observation and activities that the teacher has implemented. This cycle repeats itself roughly every 2 weeks. So it's a continuous stream of feedback and support to teachers. Not a shred of evaluation in it, okay? Teachers do not receive any, we never talk to principals about this information. In fact, most principals, we had a principal talking about this just last week, saying that he wished he was more involved in this kind of support to teachers, and in fact was glad that his teachers were able to get this kind of support from us. So thus far for these 240 teachers, as we try to raise quality in some level or even it out for kids all across the state in these pre-K programs, we have over 3,000 visits to the site. We have about 2 visits per week per teacher. In the consultancy group, teachers since the beginning of the year through January have engaged in 6 of these cycles of feedback where they've been able to get this kind of individualized personal feedback and support about their practice in their classroom. I should say all these teachers are enrolled with us for 2 years. So this is just the first year of 2 years. So what we're really trying to do here is reinvent professional development. Okay, from an education school standpoint, to say, as an education school, we can begin to bring professional development, make it focused on an individual teacher's practice, and driven from the best scientific evidence that we have available for what matters in classrooms. So now, you know, I told you I wasn't all that confident in stories, but stories are great when they really say the thing that you want them to say. So I'm going to end with a couple of stories that teachers have told us about their engagement in this process. And this teacher tells us, I think teachers and administrators have a great deal to gain from this type of training and consulting. This is a fantastic collection of activities. It's going to be great to have these. I wish I had something like this to help me when I first started teaching. I was speaking with a previous administrator and told her all about my participation with MTP. I told her I felt this was a breakthrough in teacher training and could have a huge impact. And this is a group of teachers. We had a meeting today with 3 of us that are involved in your project, and we were all raving. We love it. Thank you again for this outstanding opportunity. So I think in some ways, what I've tried to describe here in sort of a brief and sort of run-through fashion, I apologize for going fairly rapidly through some of this, but that what we've done, I think, over the last 10 years is to be engaged in a process of research on classrooms that first tried to describe what's out there and try to say, what is it that matters in classrooms and what is its distribution in the population? What are kids exposed to? Is there a problem that we need to fix or isn't there a problem we need to fix? Is what we observe related in ways to the kinds of things that we debate about in education, the things that we think are going to fix it? And in point of fact, it doesn't look that way. We've been able to detect within those observations aspects of classrooms that do seem to matter in very reliable, very robust ways for kids. Not huge effects, but very detectable effects that matter and could matter even more if they were pinned one to another over the long run. And then finally, what we've tried to do is to say, you know, if those are the things that matter for kids in classrooms, and teachers do seem to be struggling honestly to try to provide them to kids, what is it that we as an education school can do based on that knowledge to engage in the kind of support to teachers about their practice that they say to us matters for them? And that's, in the end, what we're trying to do here. All I have now, as I said, is stories. I hope, in another year or two, I can give the talk and tell you that we actually have findings associated with that. So I appreciate your listening to me. Well, thank you.